Today we're introducing the idea of work in physics, so let's go ahead and get started. First of all, the definition for work you can see is an action that causes a change in energy. Now we've been talking about all sorts of different energy here the last couple of weeks, and specifically last class we talked about mechanical energy, energy that can only be changed by putting a force on an object in order to change its energy. So mechanical work is work that causes a change in the mechanical types of energy, which would be gravitational potential energy, kinetic energy, or the elastic potential energy that you have when you stretch an object. So a very big point to understand here is that mechanical work is done to an object. You do work to the object. When you push it, you have to push it with a force. But this is critical. The force that you are talking about has to be moving it in some distance in the same direction as the force. Now we can discuss what happens if they're at an angle to each other, but you only consider the force that acts in the same direction as the motion of the object. So we have some examples down here. This person here is pushing the box, so they put a force, they move it through that distance, so they're doing work. What does that work do? It speeds the box up, which gives it kinetic energy. This results in a change in kinetic energy. Remember, work causes a change in energy. With this, we've got a slingshot. The person's pulling back, so they exerted a force. They put that force through a distance, so this is causing a change in elastic potential energy. And then finally, you got an elevator. It's rising up, so there's a force pushing it up. It moves a distance in the same direction, so it gains gravitational potential energy. Now, if we want to take a look at the formula, here's a formula triangle. If we want to solve for any of these three, remember we cover them up to rearrange the equation. So starting out, if we want to find work, we cover up work, and these two items are next to each other, which means we multiply. So work is force multiplied by distance moved. Remember, it's not how far it is away from you, it is the distance it has moved while you're exerting that force. That point's going to come up later. Now, what if I want to solve for force? So we'll cover up force, and the equation for that has work on top, distance moved on bottom, so then force equals work divided by distance. And then finally, if we want to solve for distance, we cover that up. We have work on top, force on bottom, so distance is work over force. Now, as far as the units go, based on the equation that we have, force times distance, we can go ahead and get those units for force and the units for distance, multiply them together, and that'll give us our units for work. So force, as you recall, is measured in newtons. Distance is measured in meters. So technically, one of the units you could measure work in is a newton times a meter. And that's perfectly fine. You get 100% if you go ahead and list those as your units. But I do want to point something out. If you remember, a newton breaks down into different units. So a newton is actually a kilogram times a meter per second squared, but you're still multiplying that times the meter. So if you multiply this meter times that meter, you get kilograms times meter squared over second squared. And if you recall, that unit is what we abbreviated with a joule. So what this brings you to conclude is that when you measure work, it can be measured in joules or newton meters. A newton meter is the same as a joule. So based on these ideas, what we want to discuss is work being done in these different situations, just to give you a good feel for whether work's being done in any of the problems that we do. So in situation number one, it says you lift up a box. Well, is work being done? If you say yes or you say no, you should be able to tell us why. If you say yes, there should be a change in energy. So is work done? The answer is yes. Why? What kind of energy is being changed? Well, if you take a look, they're lifting the box up. And think to yourself, what kind of energy is gained when you lift an object up? You gain gravitational energy. In situation two, you start walking while carrying the box. So at the beginning, you're sitting still, and then you start moving. So what happened? You changed your speed. So is work done? Yes, because what kind of energy changed as you were still and started to walk? You changed your kinetic energy. When you change your speed, you change your kinetic energy. So that means work is done in that case as well. And then, oh, that should say situation three, but in situation three, you walk while carrying the box at a constant speed. So you're holding it up, it has gravitational energy. You're walking, it has kinetic energy. So is work being done? The answer is no. Now you may be confused because you're saying to yourself, but it has energy. But remember, we're asking about the change in energy. So there is no change in energy because the kinetic energy and the gravitational energy are staying the same. They're not getting larger, they're not getting smaller. Now, there are situations similar to that where no work is being done, so it's important just to go ahead and point those out. So those situations are in these cases, when work is not done, it's when forces cause no displacement of the object, so you can push on it, but you're not causing it to move, or when no part of the force is in the same direction as the object's motion. In other words, the force is perpendicular 90 degrees to the object's displacement. So we have these three situations where no work is being done. Can you explain why each situation shows no work being done on the object? So we've got the Earth, the moon going around the Earth. It goes at a pretty constant speed. It stays at a pretty constant height. So even though it has gravitational energy due to the height above the ground, it's not changing. So there's no change, no work done with the gravitational energy. What about the motion sideways? Well, it does have sideways speed, so it has kinetic energy, but it goes at a fairly constant speed as it goes around the Earth, so there's no change in kinetic energy, meaning there's no work being done if the energy doesn't change. Now, the reason why that happens is because it's being pushed down, but it's being moved over, so the push down appears to have no effect on the sideways speed. So again, when they are perpendicular, the force and the speed, or the force and the displacement, are perpendicular 90 degrees to each other, there is no work being done. Same case here. If you're walking forward, if you push up on the object, but you're moving sideways, you're not doing work on the object. It's not gaining gravitational energy because you're not lifting it, you're just holding it up. It's not gaining kinetic energy because you're just walking at a steady speed. You're just holding it up against gravity, but you're not adding to its energy. So there's no work being done, and that will always happen when the force and the displacement are at 90 degrees to each other. And then finally, in this situation, what's this guy doing? He's exerting a large force. However, what's the displacement? What's the distance moved? Well, that wall is not moving at all. So he has a force, but there's zero distance, so there's no work being done. And then for our last 2 points, just a quick discussion here, negative work. Negative work is when the force is acting in the opposite direction as the object's motion. So here this person is pushing forward. They're causing positive work because the object's moving in the same direction they push. So they're putting energy in. It would speed the object up, give it kinetic energy. But friction between the bottom of the object and the floor, friction's always going to push you backwards. And so friction always causes negative work to be done because it is always acting to slow the object down. It's taking the kinetic energy out of the object. So when they're in opposite directions, we already discussed, one's positive, one's negative, and it still applies in this situation. And then finally, forces acting at an angle. We discussed this, but we said if you're being pushed at an angle to the direction of the motion, then only the part of the force that is in the direction of motion counts. Now, we're not going to do the math with this. It involves a little bit of sine and cosine, but this is the situation we're talking about. If this person is pulling up at an angle, the force that they pull over with is in the same direction as the object moves. So that amount of force multiplied by the distance you moved would be the amount of work done. However, part of that force is also lifting up, but she didn't actually lift the object up. It pulled up on the box, but didn't cause it to move up, so that does no work. So if you have taken a little bit of Algebra 2 and you've learned a little bit about sine and cosine, there's actually a lot of uses there. This is one of those where you can split the force up into how much force over, how much force up, and use only the force over in the distance to calculate the work done. So let's try some example problems now. In our first example, we have an elevator that's being pushed upward with 540 newtons, and it rises 30 meters at a constant speed. So we've got this situation. Was there a change in the object's energy? If so, what type of energy was changed? When the elevator does this, what kind of energy is changing, if any? Well, hopefully you realize it's gaining height, so it's gaining gravitational energy. So because it is gaining gravitational potential energy as a result of that force, work is being done, and we can solve for it. So how much work is being done on the elevator? So we're looking for the amount of work. Now let's take a look at the information we have. We know that we've got 540 newtons of force and 30 meters. So you write those numbers down. And again, based on the units, you can see, hey, newtons, that measures the force on the object, and meters, that measures the distance. So we need to figure out how we're going to solve for the work if you know the force and the distance. So you recall our formula triangle. We're looking for work, so we cover it up. And that means force and distance are next to each other, so that implies that we're going to multiply those. Now all you have to do is plug in 540 for the force and 30 meters for the distance. And when you multiply those two numbers together, you get 16,200 joules of newton meters of work. Now remember, a newton meter is the same thing as a joule. So you could also write your answer as 16,200 joules. I will point out, this is actually kind of a bit of an important fact. The amount of joules of work that you do is the amount of energy it gained. So if you took this problem, plugged it in your potential energy equation, you'd see that the object would have gained 16,200 joules of gravitational potential energy, and that is because the same amount of work was done to it to give it that energy. For example number two, if the situation is a weightlifter, they're holding a 400 newton barbell steadily over his head, and it's 2 meters above the floor. So was there any change in the object's energy? If so, what type of energy changed? So in this situation, you see the barbell being held above the person's head. Do you see a change in energy? Now some people may say, well yeah, it's got gravitational energy, but is it changing if he's holding it there? The answer to that is no. He's holding it. So since he's holding it, there's no change in energy. Again, because it has energy doesn't mean it's changing. In order to do work, the energy has to change its amount. So we automatically know the amount of work was done was zero. But if you want to prove it mathematically, this is how you could go about it. If you want to know how much work was done, then we can go ahead and say, well, you got 400 newtons. And you might say to yourself, well, the distance was 2 meters. But no, that's not the distance it moved. He was holding it. So it actually moved a distance of 0 meters. So when you plug in your formula, find work, force times distance, that's 400 meters times zero. So mathematically, it comes out to be what we predicted it. The amount of work done was zero. And again, you can go back and say it either way. Conceptually, you can say there's no change in energy, so I know no work was done. Or mathematically, you can plug in the numbers and see that there was zero work done in that case as well. And then finally, example problem number three. You have a 60 kilogram water skier. They're starting from rest, so they're not moving, a speed of zero, and they accelerate forward as she's pulled with 120 newtons. She continues to speed up until 810 joules of work has been done to her. So the situation again, they're sitting still. They speed up until 810 joules of work is being done. So is there a change in the object's energy? If so, what type of energy changed? Well, if she was sitting still and she started moving, then she gained kinetic energy. So yes, she gained kinetic energy as she sped up, so we know work was done. In this situation though, we're not being asked to solve for the work. We happen to know the work. We're being asked for the distance the water skier moved. So if we're trying to find distance, let's go ahead and take a look at what we know. We know the 60 kilograms, 120 newtons, and 810 joules. So we can write those values down. Now remember, kilograms, 60 kilograms is the amount of mass. 120 newtons is how much force she was being pushed with, and the problem did state that we had 810 joules of work. So we are looking for distance. We take a look at our formula triangle. If I'm looking for distance, you cover it up, and we see that work is on top, force is on bottom, so our formula is distance equals work divided by force. You notice we don't even use the mass here in this situation. It's just going to be these two numbers. So you plug in the work on top, the force on bottom. We're going to get a number, but take a look at these units. A joule divided by newton. You may say, well, then the answer is going to be joule per newton, which technically is correct, but we can make it a little bit more easy to understand. If you recall, a joule is the same thing as a newton times a meter. And so when you take newton meters and you divide by newtons, the newtons will cancel out, and all we're left with is meters. So our final answer, the number comes out to be 6.75 meters. That is the number and the units combined written down correctly. So now that we've been through this, there's what you need to do. You need to make sure you complete the work problems in the quizzes section on Canvas. You've got to earn at least 80% to receive credit, so make sure that if you don't receive the 80%, you retake it again until you do. If you have questions, as always, please contact me. I've been getting back with everybody who's been asking me questions, and things seem to be going pretty well. Good luck, folks. I wish you the best.